Thank you, Tim. Well, it's great to see you all here. So we're all Toastmasters, right? All right. How many are Toastmasters from Fountain Hills? Okay, about half. And the others, where are you from?
Tempe, Spice It Up.
Spice It Up. Ooh, it used to be Talk Scoop.
Yes, Talk Scoop.
I was a mentor over there. Who else is not from Fountain Hills Toastmasters?
Air Park Toastmasters.
Air Park, okay.
Platinum.
Platinum.
Platinum Toastmasters.
Premium Toastmasters.
Premium. All right, so we have Toastmasters from around town. You're here to learn the art of evaluation. Now, you've all given evaluations. Unless you're brand new and you've only gone to one meeting, the chances are you've given an evaluation. We're going to have some slides that kind of guide me and you through the evaluation. Let's first talk about the benefits. First, the benefit for the evaluator. Now, a lot of times we think of, well, what are the benefits for the speaker? But the evaluator, he gets benefits from this as well. You learn by helping others. And a lot of us do genuinely want to help our members improve. We're helpful people. It helps you to develop an attitude of interest in new things because you'll have to pay attention to someone else's speech. What they say, how they say it, the arguments they use, the illustrations they make. It builds positive relationships, especially if you do evaluations right, the Toastmaster way. You will make a friend with that person that you're evaluating. You'll develop listening skills.
Sorry, I just want to check, make sure your camera
it is.
Okay,
yeah, I made sure of that before. We're taping this so that we can show it on YouTube later. It's for anybody who wants to watch it. Listening skills. There's a lot of ways in Toastmasters to listen. In evaluation, the first thing is watch and listen. And, of course, it's an impromptu speaking opportunity. You have not had a long time to work on your evaluation. Maybe just 20 minutes, 10 minutes, or even 5 minutes. Today, we have 3 evaluators who will have very little time to prepare after the speakers have given their speeches. So it's going to help you with that. How does it help speakers? Well, the obvious thing is it's a learning aid, especially for new members who haven't developed a high level of skill yet. It provides recognition to the member. Again, a good evaluation is going to motivate that speaker. It's going to empower them. It's going to boost their self-esteem. It's going to do that regardless of whether that speech was a good speech or a bad speech. And I say bad speech in the best way. We've all seen speeches that weren't polished. They weren't organized. They were rough, and that's okay, because we're here to learn. And how do you learn? You give it, you get the evaluation back, you adjust, and you try it again next time, learning something new. It provides ego fulfillment. How many of you really enjoy getting up and speaking in front of your group? I know I do. Do you guys like to speak? You like people to hear your ideas, your stories. And that doesn't make you an egotist. That makes you an interesting person. It also provides a motivation for the speakers to come back. Only occasionally in my 20 years in Toastmasters have I seen a member who gave their first speech and then disappeared. It's happened, but rarely. And we want that speaker to come back again and do this, do another speech, learning what they can do better. We're going to talk a lot about self-esteem in this because it helps their self-esteem as well. And self-esteem sometimes takes on a negative connotation if it's applied poorly. In this case, I think we all agree, self-esteem is important. It doesn't become all-encompassing. It doesn't drive every waking moment. But self-esteem, a positive self-esteem, is good. It can also help the club. It helps the club by raising your standards. A good evaluation is going to result in what? Better speakers. Better speakers is going to result in better leaders, more guests who come and say, wow, I want to be like them. and they joined. So it helps you to improve your club. It makes for a positive climate. I wouldn't stick around in a club that didn't have a positive atmosphere. Either a fun atmosphere, a friendly atmosphere, some sort of positive atmosphere. I've been in a club that did not have any of those things. And I did not stay. And the last I heard, they folded soon after. It was really a toxic environment. It will develop role models in the club. A good evaluator becomes a role model for the new members. Because evaluation is one of the toughest things for a new member to learn how to do well. Why? We hardly get anything like a good evaluation outside of Toastmasters. How many of you get really solid, motivating, self-esteem building evaluations at work? Good for you, I'm glad. But not too many hands went up. I know that when I got work evaluations before I retired, they weren't necessarily negative, they were just useless. Because they were superficial. They didn't really get into helping me improve. And if they did talk about things, it was how can the company improve, not how could the employee improve. So we want to be role models. And we want people to keep coming to the meetings. Now, today's objectives are simple. First, to help us recognize the purpose and the value of effective speech evaluations. How can we improve those evaluation skills, specific ways, individually and as a club? And then to stimulate group discussion about a very important part of every club experience, and that's evaluation. I'd go out on a limb here a little bit, but not very far, to say if we didn't have an evaluation component in a Toastmaster meeting, Toastmasters wouldn't have survived out of the 20s. Ralph would not have been a name that we remember 100 years later as the starter of Toastmasters. It would just be people talking and not getting any better. All right. Why do people want to learn to speak? Let me get some ideas. What do you think? Ideas. Why do people want to learn to speak? Yes?
Career advancement.
Career advancement, okay. Anything else?
To overcome fear.
To overcome fear, okay. Allie, why do you think?
I would say to learn to express themselves better so that there's more clarity.
To be more clear when they communicate. Okay. Those are all great ideas. Why do we do that? First, it's to gain knowledge and skills. And we heard that. We want to get better at doing it. Sometimes we have a specific need, like a job advancement. You know that this next job ladder, right there in the job description, it said, must be able to communicate clearly. Public speaking. Okay, you can check that off. Coming to Toastmasters. Sometimes you've been asked to be the best man at a wedding, and you've never given a speech in your life. So you've got a really narrowly focused goal. Toastmasters can help. To gain material rewards, such as a job advancement. Or perhaps you want to go into business, a business of speaking. A lot of people join Toastmasters with a goal of becoming a professional speaker. To earn credit towards recognition. Now in Toastmasters, most people who join Toastmasters don't join to get some initials after their name. They don't know about those things. They don't know about CC and AC and DTM. But once they get into the program and they're introduced to these people who have achieved those levels, they get interested, and they seek that now as a new goal. Sometimes it's just fun. Maybe you're a comic, and you need to find a way to get yourself out there and maybe make people laugh. That's your role in life. You want to build self-esteem. Maybe you are not so much fearful of speaking, but you're afraid that you won't look good. You don't have a good feeling about yourself. And build self-confidence. When I joined to just improve my skills. I wasn't nervous at all. I just wasn't any good. So I joined, and that was 20 years ago. And sometimes people do it to be accepted. Whether that's a politician who wants to become elected and be a public servant, whether it's a movie star who wants to win a prize on the stage, or whether it's just a regular person who has a great idea and they want that idea to be considered. How do we improve? The method of improving is really, this diagram could be drawn a little better. It could be drawn as a circle. The first box says behavior. It's a little unclear in that. It says behavior, and on the bottom it says speech. That's your behavior. The next box says feedback. Well, we call that an evaluation. And then it repeats. Behavior, feedback, behavior, feedback, behavior. You could draw that as a circle, continuous improvement. Give a speech, get evaluated, come back again and do a better speech. Three roles of an evaluator. Make sure I catch up to my script. Motivator. Now, motivation is not external. I can't motivate you. Motivation must come within. But I can provide some fuel for that motivation by giving you an evaluation that honors your effort and, if it needs to be improved, gives you a way to do that. Provides you a tool, a method to improve. We do that by recognizing improvement. One of the best techniques as an evaluator is to, if you know the speaker and you've been watching their performance and their speeches in the past, pay attention to how much they've improved. Now, don't say it if you don't believe it or you haven't noticed it. But if you have, and I think every one of us has seen people. They came in and they were pretty rough. They really weren't that solid. But the next speech and the next speech and the next speech, better and better. Comment on that. Make sure you're reinforcing their desire to come back and do another speech. Facilitator. Sometimes the speaker gives the speech and you give that feedback, but you need to give them ideas on how to improve. You have to facilitate their improvement, facilitate their development. Don't be a critic, be an evaluator. Now, critic is not necessarily a negative. What does a critic do? A critic finds positives and negatives. An evaluator finds methods for improvement. And you have to go through the analysis first, what needs improvement. But be an evaluator, not a critic. And sometimes, they're a counselor. Now, it could be that this member already has a mentor, and you don't need to be in the mentor's role necessarily. But it depends on the member, and it depends on your club climate. Be prepared as an evaluator to perhaps talk to them after the meeting and get into it a little deeper, especially if you know their history. Maybe you know that they're going through a bad time in their life. Maybe their mom's in the hospital and they're just not concentrating. They're preoccupied. If you know that ahead of time, just back off on your evaluation a little bit, because they're already going through a lot. That being a counselor is not the main role, but it sometimes happens. Now, self-esteem. We talked about self-esteem a little bit earlier. Self-esteem, it's a development process. It fuels personal growth. In other words, you provide a process, a way, for that person to grow and to improve. What happens after you give someone an evaluation that's motivating and positive, give some ideas for improvement, nothing negative, no slams, no whitewashes? A whitewash is just as bad as a negative, in my opinion. When you've done that, that person will respect themselves a little bit, and they'll respect the process, and they will be motivated to come back and do it again. It reinforces personal growth. So, once you get the feedback, you start to get better. Maybe it's your technique that gets better. Maybe it's your attitude that gets better. Maybe it's simply your confidence level in your abilities gets better. Once you grow, you start to feel better about yourself. You can do more. You see how this feeds? It's a process that grows and grows, like an avalanche. If you've ever run into Toastmasters that you admire, go up to them and ask them about their history. Have them tell you about the early days when they were just a baby Toastmaster. Find out about their path. It keeps on going. More self-esteem, more growth, more improvement. You get better. And by this time, of course, this speaker has started to become a good evaluator as well. I hope you understand that it all feeds on that. You as a speaker get an evaluation, it's a good one. You will want to use that technique yourself when you're in front doing the evaluation. How can we as evaluators feed this self-esteem? What kind of fuel can we offer? Be genuine. People can read fake in your eyes, in your expression, in the words you use. Be genuine. That it doesn't mean to be, this is not the same as being brutally honest and telling someone they stunk. Okay? That's not what genuine is. Be honest and sincere. And the desire should be to desire to help. That's your sincerity. I want to help. If they feel that you're on their side, they're going to feel better about it. Recognize the strengths. Every speaker will bring strengths to a speech. Every speaker. It doesn't matter who they are. It doesn't matter how many years they've been speaking. You can be a DTM, I've done 500 speeches, and every speech will bring strengths and ways to improve. But the very beginning speaker, sometimes, how many of you are amazed at some of your icebreaker speeches that you hear? I am. So these are great. Others are what are normal, what you'd expect, a little hesitant, not very organized, but some are just out of the box doing great. Recognize the improvements. We talked about that a little bit already. But if you've seen the improvement, recognize it and remark on it, especially if you can remark on something specific in the evaluation, such as, I was looking in your manual, I noticed last time there was a note about you need to improve on eye contact. Boy, you had it. Eye contact today is great. Talk about those specifics if you can. Create a climate for motivation. Again, give the speaker permission to want to improve. Give them permission. Give them an attitude of, yeah, it's okay to come back and try it again. In fact, it's even okay to come back and do that exact same speech again if that's what you need to do. As an evaluator, you shouldn't be afraid to suggest that. If it's warranted. Avoid value judgments. We're not here to judge the content of their speech. We're not here to judge the character of the person. And unless if you're in a situation where you just abhor a particular Toastmaster, I suggest the problem is you. Okay? And we don't have that situation very often. And it usually takes care of itself because those people that are not in good terms together will tend to separate. One will leave. But don't put any value judgments in your evaluation. You're here to talk about their speech technique, the way they did it, the way it made you feel, and that's legit, the way it made me feel. But if it's a topic that you're not comfortable with, or something that person has done, solve those problems offline. The evaluation is not the place to unload. Provide positive direction. It's one thing to say, oh, you did great. Okay, what did I do well? Well, I don't know, but it was great. Well, that's not a very effective evaluation point. And also you say, well, I think this speech could be better. But if you don't say how, they won't know. So I expect of myself, every time I give an evaluation, to have some specific things to do to improve. One of our speakers yesterday morning at my Inawatuki Club gave a PowerPoint presentation, and in the middle was an audio clip of a gentleman who she met, she wrote a book about, who survived Auschwitz. And she recorded him telling his stories. And it was a very powerful moment. Someone said, you should have saved that for the end. And she agreed instantly. She understood the impact. Very specific. It didn't take long to figure that one out. Now this section we're going to skip over. We had an assessment form that would be, if we were all in the same club, we basically score ourselves. How well do we do? We're going to skip that. We're on slide 9. Check my map. Doing great. What time is it?
6:35.
We're right on. We started, what, about 10 minutes after the schedule? Okay. So I'll go a little further. And then we'll have a break. Got those great snacks back there. Before I go on, are there any questions about anything we've said so far? Anything we've talked about? Okay.
I have a question, Don. Trying to keep emotion out of your evaluation, I know I struggle with being very direct. Can you give us some examples of how you might be able to diffuse those things as they come to your mind?
Well, when you say emotion, what kind of emotion? Anger? Or?
It could be a lot of different emotions. Sometimes it's like, oh, I really don't understand what you just said. It was completely disorganized, and you're almost mad that they've wasted your time. Okay.
Never, of course, say that out loud. Because even if it's true, I wouldn't even try to keep emotion out of an evaluation unless you're out of control. For instance, if someone gave a speech that's very moving, and you can't get up there without crying because you're moved by the message, and you can't even utter a word without breaking down, that's, at that point, probably you just need to say, I need help. Someone take over for me, please. But I wouldn't take the emotion out of it, because that's part of the genuineness. How did you respond? On the specific point of, how do I tell someone that it was so disorganized I didn't understand and it was wasting my time? Simply say, this speech objective was to get organized. And there were some parts in here that I got lost. And I couldn't quite follow your point. You notice the word, I use the word I. It's not you got lost, I got lost. And then say something like, I suggest that you take a look at this, and perhaps before you write it, did you write an outline? Do it in outline form so you get your main points, you know what you're going to say, and then flesh it out. Give them some suggestions for how to change the sequence. In other words, if you were doing this speech, what would you have done? And then put that in words for them. I do that all the time. I'm always rewriting somebody else's speech in my head as I hear it. And I think, I could do that better. Or, boy, I've done that before, and that really works, and it worked for them too. So don't keep the emotion out of it, again, unless you're losing it. I think we will take a break now. Take a 10-minute break. We'll have some refreshments in the back. We'll keep on going for a little longer after this, and then what's going to happen at the second half is we're going to have three speeches and three evaluators. Those speakers have been identified and the evaluators have been chosen. They know who they are. And I hope they're not sweating bullets, because this is just, we're just Toastmasters. Ignore the fact that you're on the video camera. I tell that to my other Toastmasters all the time. I use this camera in my club meetings, by the way. It's an excellent evaluation tool. You give it to them privately. If they want to, if they give you permission to publish it on YouTube, great. But it's up to them. You give them their speech. They can go watch it with their mentor or watch it by themselves. And we've done a couple hundred speeches like that at Inawatuki, and it's great. Let's take a break. Well, thank you all for coming back. I think everybody came back. Didn't have any deserters, okay. All right, well, before we get going, any other questions that came to mind during the break before we move on? Yes, sir.
I see myself following a pattern where if I do not agree with the contents, then I start providing my feedback or evaluation on the content side. Whereas what I just learned is that it's the speech which is meant to be evaluated, not the contents. If I give an example, we talked about ego and self-esteem and such generic terms. I may carry a different interpretation of them, whereas the speaker may carry a different interpretation. And if I disagree with some of them, then I may content that in my evaluation. That's, I guess, is not good. But I have not been able to refrain myself to get rid of it.
Okay. It's a skill. We're trying to learn a skill. We don't come out of, you know, you don't join Toastmasters and instantly you're a good evaluator. It's something you have to learn. I encourage you to try to stay away from content. If content is objectionable at a high enough level, there's a side conversation after the meeting that needs to be held. Years ago at a speech contest, I witnessed a contest speech at the area that was profane, highly profane, very suggestive, and the speaker was proud of his speech. His club was proud of him for doing something bold. Everybody else thought it was disgusting. And that club folded soon after, because that wasn't a good club climate. Now, I've had a few cases where people will give a speech that's politically charged, and we live in a society that can get politically charged at the drop of a tweet. Any tweet. So try to discipline yourself. Consider the technique used. Was it clear? Even if you don't agree with what they said, was it clear what they said? Did they support their point? Did they use good body language? What was the objective of the speech? If the objective was the speech was to have vocal variety, concentrate on that, vocal variety. Later, if you want to talk to that person about the content and try to, you know, debate it, that's different. That's not what an evaluation is for. But I appreciate you for being honest about that. It's something you know you want to work on, and that's the point. So how do we build a positive club climate? Well, this is really what the club can come into play, is the club can make sure that you insist on positive evaluations. You insist and train your members and show by example what a good evaluation looks like. And there's not one way to do an evaluation. And a brand new Toastmaster can give a good evaluation. I tell brand new Toastmasters who are nervous at their first evaluation, I said, look, you haven't been around enough to learn the technical jargon and the techniques. So what did I hear? What did I see? What did I feel? Stick with that, and you'll give a solid evaluation. But after you get some skill and after you get some evaluations under your belt, always make sure the speaker knows what they did well and why. specifics. Just saying it was good. Okay, fine. Well, what was good about it? Well, I don't know. It was good. And they need to know, they better want to know what they can do to improve. And how. By the way, that's very similar to the grammarian job. Who in here enjoys being the grammarian? It's one of my favorite ones. You hear it, you know it's wrong, but do you just limit yourself to, oh, you said that wrong? Or do you provide, no, I think a better way to have said that would be this. Give them a version that doesn't break the grammar rule, or makes it more clear, or makes a better use of a word that's being used out of context. So build this in your club, in your culture. Have a social aspect of your club. Now, most clubs do this very well. You come and you meet people every week. You get to know them. You get to know where they work and what they do. Make that a big part of your club culture. Because if you know someone, that example I gave earlier of a speaker whose mother is in the hospital, if you knew that because of your relationship with the as a friend or you were sensitive to that, you can change your evaluation accordingly. How many of you assign members to roles ahead of time? There's a roster ahead of time. Raise your hand. Okay. Everybody else, how do you do it? Do you have volunteers? Ahead of time volunteers? Okay, so you pass a list around who wants to be this or that. How many, are any of you in clubs where it's just the day of? You just walk in and you just hand out the assignments? Kind of like what I did tonight with the three evaluators?
Sometimes by default.
Sometimes by default because someone's not there, right? What I recommend you do, and this is partly my personal opinion, but it's also something that was recommended in the guide. Assign evaluators ahead of time. Who can tell me why that would be a good idea? Yes, sir.
It's very helpful for both the speaker and the evaluator to try to make sure that they're close in ability. Not putting a first-time evaluator with a very proficient speaker.
Right, exactly. If a distinguished Toastmaster was speaking and you asked the member who joined last Tuesday to be his evaluator, that would be awkward. There's another good reason.
Gives the evaluator a chance to look over what the objectives are.
Bingo. You get a chance to talk before the meeting. And if you don't do that as a regular thing in your club, I hope you start. Because the evaluator needs to understand what the objectives are. And it's not really fair to the speaker for you to come in the day of, take a quick glance at their manual, because you're surrounded by people saying hello, and maybe the food's arriving if you have a breakfast club. You may not understand the objectives. Or if the speaker has some special requirements. They want you to look at their eye contact, even though eye contact wasn't part of the objective. They want you to keep an eye on it. Encourage dialogue between speakers and evaluators. We just talked about that. For all the right reasons. If you know what the speaker's trying to accomplish, you can be a better evaluator. You can listen better and more focused, and when you're giving the evaluation, you can be focused. Do you evaluate your evaluators? During your general evaluation time, that would be a good job for the general evaluator. It does not have to be an extensive evaluation. But I recommend that your general evaluator spend a minute or two at the end of their part to talk about the three or two evaluations that you just had. If we have enough time tonight, we're going to do just that. Three speeches, three evaluators. We're going to have a chance to talk about it. Encourage group evaluations. This is something, I do this in my clubs, especially on contest speakers. We'll have a speech contest, and the winner is going to go on to the area level. So we'll do a round-robin evaluation. where everybody gets a chance to give suggestions to the contest speaker. And of course, the contest speaker is responsible for making up his or her mind about whether to take that idea or not. But that's one way to do group evaluations. One of the more advanced techniques that's in the book is a kind of evaluation where you actually spend about as much time on this evaluation as you do on the speech, because it's a back and forth discussion between the evaluator and the speaker. Most clubs don't do that. Most clubs don't have time to do that. Emphasize manual speeches. Oh, if you're really giving permission to your members to go off the manual, you're kind of missing the benefit of a system that's been around for over 90 years. It's been fine-tuned, adjusted for very good reasons. The books are there for a reason. I encourage all of your speeches to be manual speeches. Now, there's three basic techniques. There's a tell and sell, which is basic what most Toastmaster clubs do. The evaluator stands in front, tells the group and the speaker what he or she thought about it, and tries to sell these ideas for improvement to the speaker. The speaker doesn't say anything. This has a couple of advantages and some disadvantages. The main advantage is fast. If you don't get into a dialogue with the speaker or other people in the group, you can be done with an evaluation in 2 minutes, 2.5, 3, depending on what your club's schedule is. So brevity is a big plus. However, it really works only if the evaluator is actually accurate in their assessment. If the evaluator missed the point or wasn't listening and didn't hear a piece and goes on that assumption, now the speaker is wondering they weren't listening. They get defensive. And maybe they tune out. Maybe they don't really listen to you anymore. If you didn't bother to hear what my point was, I did say all of those things you're telling me. So it can get put speakers on the defensive. And if that's in an extreme case, you might actually cause a break between those individuals. They might, in fact, take that as an attack. And now we're in deep water. We don't want to be there. So there's an advantage of brevity, and there's an advantage of a quick agenda. Well, what else could we do? We could have a tell and listen. This is where the evaluator gives an evaluation. But then the speaker has a formal rebuttal, if you will, to clear up any points that might be just factual things. For instance, I wasn't clear on where you were going with that step, and they could say, well, I was trying to organize it chronologically, but perhaps maybe what you're saying is it should have been done topically. It would have been more easy to understand that way. So there could be a give and take, and that has a lot of potential. But it takes time. How many of you have a time crunch kind of agenda? Most of us. Especially if it's at a work setting, you got to be done. Back to work. Another positive, it removes any kind of defensive feeling, because now the speaker can defend themselves. They can answer that point and clarify it. It builds a positive relationship. And it helps the evaluator to improve. Here, the evaluator just got taught a lesson about maybe listening or a technique that the speaker was using that they weren't familiar with. Probably the most effective method is the problem-solving method, but it takes a long time. It's the most difficult, and it really requires several steps. First, the speaker, before the speech, you ask the speaker directly or exactly what their concerns are. Now, we can do that offline, so most of us do that part already. Identify the strengths Ask questions, non-threatening questions like, do you, to the speaker, do you think you met the objectives of the manual? Instead of saying, I don't think you met the objectives of the manual. Allow a dialogue. Or perhaps you could say, why did you choose that particular topic? As a way to get a decision or open a conversation about maybe a topic that was inappropriate in some way. Or perhaps a topic that really didn't lend itself to the objectives. But ask them. Get a dialogue going. You do that. The problem, again, with this one is time. Because you could easily spend 5 or 7 minutes on that kind of an evaluation. I made a note in the margin here. This might be a better thing for a mentor to do with that speaker. Offline is talk about that speech. If you've got the video, watch the video together. And you can start and stop the tape and break it down. Ten behaviors. We're going to talk about behaviors of the evaluator. Start by showing that you care. How do you show that you care? It can be in body language. It can be in tone of voice. It can be in whether you're smiling when you're talking about the speech. Very simple human characteristics. People can tell whether you don't care about them. And sometimes it's in the nonverbal clues, but sometimes it's in the words you choose or in the tone of voice. If your tone of voice is, I wouldn't say hostile, but maybe flat and unaffected, as opposed to buoyant and interesting, and you putting your own, do you use vocal variety when you give your evaluation? If it isn't, if it's a dull monotone evaluation, what is your speaker going to think? Suit the evaluation to the speaker. We've talked about this a little bit. If it's a new speaker, a brand new speaker, and you're an experienced evaluator, by now, if you're experienced, you know you need to treat this speaker with kid gloves a little bit. You don't want to scare them away. You don't want to discourage them, especially if they're not one of the superstars out of the box kind of speaker. They're a regular speaker. Maybe they ran out of time, and you ask them about it, and they go, well, when I practiced at home, it was 15 minutes, and then I edited a little, and it still came out to 12 minutes. Help them through that with some ideas for how to improve the flow in the organization, how to edit. Give them something specific. You didn't need to tell us 5 stories about your childhood in the orphanage. Okay. One story would have got the idea across to us and would have taken a lot of time out. So give them some specific ideas. On the other end of the scale, if it's an experienced speaker, expect more from that speaker. It's okay. If you're a distinguished Toastmaster, you better have an evaluator who calls you on being a distinguished Toastmaster. You are expected to perform at a higher level. That doesn't mean you are perfect. I've never seen a perfect speech. I've never given a perfect speech. But it can be challenging, and especially if you match up a young evaluator and experienced speaker. But match the speaker or suit your evaluation to the speaker, no matter what the assignment is. Learn the speaker's objectives. Easy. This is basic Toastmasters. If you know what the objective is, you can be listening and making specific notes about that. By the way, that means you know what the objectives are in the manual. You've got their book. Read the objectives. If you haven't looked at it recently, or it's a manual you've never used, make sure you look in it. If you've contacted the speaker the day before and they're in an advanced book that you don't have, go online. There's some bootleg copies of everything out there. You'll find that somebody's scanned a PDF of every manual somewhere. Or go to your club library. You all do have a library of all the advanced speaker books, right? For your members to check out, right? If you don't, you might want to consider it. $75, you can get all, whatever, 19 or 18 advanced books. Have them on hand. So when your members graduate out of CC, they have an idea of what to expect. Oops, I missed one. Sorry. Listen actively. Now this is the silent part, when you're sitting in your chair watching and listening. Pay attention. It's easy to get distracted. Maybe someone's whispering next to you. Not to you necessarily, although that might be the case. Pay attention. Show that you're listening. Eye contact. You make eye contact with the speaker. Take notes. When a speaker sees you taking notes, they know something's going on. You're noting something that is good or something perhaps that needs to be improved. Listen actively. Personalize your language. And I have a slide later that's going to get into this, but you're going to be using I and me words, not you and your words. And definitely not we words. You're not speaking for the group. You're not the club spokesperson of evaluation. It's, here's what I heard. Here's my take on what I heard. I felt emotion at this point. Or I got confused when you talked, when you changed stories from when you were 12 to when you were 20. I didn't make that connection. Well, I have more of those coming up. Give positive reinforcement. This is simple. This is simple, basic stuff. Your speakers need to have faith in the process. What's the process? Give a speech, get an evaluation, get better. Give a speech, get an evaluation, get better. If they don't have any faith in that process, they're not going to try hard. They're just going to phone it in, as they say. They won't really work on their speech. They won't put their all into it. So make sure that you reinforce everything that you're doing in a positive way. During the break, we talked a little bit about how can I stay positive when what I really am feeling is either a negative or confusion or one of those other emotions. And part of that is putting on the best face. Because again, even though you're not a spokesperson, you do represent the club in the sense of showing how the process works. If you do praise something in the speech, make sure it's earned. Don't say words like, oh, your speech was beautiful, I loved it, when either you don't mean it or you can't explain why. One of the terms we use in Toastmasters is whitewash. Who's heard of the whitewash evaluation? It's just, oh, everything was gorgeous. Everything was wonderful. Oh, I loved it. I sure hope to see you next time. Boy, that was great. Not a single method in there discussed. Not a single development point. It's hollow flattery. And it can only go so far. Build a motivational climate. Again, this gets back to your club culture. Does your club celebrate in positive ways? Do you have recognition events? Do you encourage speakers to work hard towards doing a great job? Do you have awards that you give? How many clubs or people in here have a club where you have some kind of an award based on attendance or the number of times you've won the best trophy or anything like that? My home club has what they call a Toastmaster on the Move award. It's very easy, it's very simple. It's a little point system. If you win the best speech, you get 5 points. If you win most improved speaker, you get 3 points. So on. At the end of the month, who has the most points? And what is their reward? not money, not fame. They get to hand out the awards at the end of the meeting. They are give the trophies out. But they're also honored every week. Everybody knows that person was the most active, did the most things, brought in the most guests, won the speech trophy the most times. Incidentally, every year we give out those traveling trophies permanently to the person who won it the most during the year. And we have a fun time with that. We make that a social affair. Evaluate behavior, not people. This kind of gets to your point about the content. We're not evaluating their opinions, their points of view, their clothing, the speech impediment, the fact that they didn't comb their hair. That's not what you're there for. And it's not even worthy of mention in any sense of it detracted or distracted me. That's a personal problem with you, being distracted by shallow things. Okay. Nourish the self-esteem. We've talked about that a number of different ways, to making sure that the speakers know that they're honored and that their contribution will be recognized. Show the speaker how to improve. Give specific examples. I'm going to move a little quicker now. My timekeeper is on the job over here. How do you personalize it? Say things like, my reaction was, it appeared to me, I felt, the I, me words. It's my opinion, after all. Don't say things like, you should have, or you failed, your opening was. This is an evaluation from you. Now, some of these will find their way into your evaluation. It's not fatal if that happens. But this is kind of like the old, I had a treasurer once who sent out the dues notice. The email said something like, dues are due by the end of the month. If you're not going to renew, let me know. Instead of, hey everybody, dues are due at the end of the month. I'm looking forward to working with you over the next 6 months. We're going to have a great club atmosphere or whatever. But if you just, if you lead them down the trail that says, well, I guess I ought to just quit. I think, a technique I have found, don't say, you should, you must, or only good speakers do this. Don't compare them to other speakers. That's not your job. And that's a value judgment on your part that might not be supported. The speakers have goals too, have responsibilities too. I'm going to go through this a little quicker because I want to get to the speeches and the evaluations. Communicate your goals. We've talked about that. What are your objectives? Make sure your evaluator knows. Help the evaluator prepare. And then do your own preparation. Read the manual. Practice it, write it out, practice it some more. Make sure you are ready. You're doing your job as the speaker. Empathize with the speaker or with the evaluator. If you've ever been an evaluator, you know how hard it is. You know it can be difficult. So make sure you understand that they are also learning. And if they give an evaluation that you don't particularly like, cut them some slack. Let them realize that they might be struggling too. They may be either new or maybe they're going through something in their life and their frame of mind is not suited for that day to be a good evaluator. Just be sensitive. Help the evaluator improve. Well, isn't it the job of the evaluator to make the speaker improve? No. Well, it goes both ways. It goes both ways. Show the evaluator how to improve. Let me see if I have an example in the book here about that. Can't find it right away. But there are, it's a two-way street. It's a two-way communication. Prepare to change. Are you ready to actually improve your speeches? Not everybody is. Sometimes you get into a plateau and you're just fine. I've been a Toastmaster for 20 years. I've done it all, seen it all. I just come for the camaraderie. Or I come for the breakfast. Or if you're near a place that serves the alcohol, I come for the drinks. Whatever it might be. But no, you should always be striving to improve. Decide what you want to change. Recognize the benefits. And then put it into action. This is an active activity. It's not passive. If it were a passive activity, you could go at home, sit on the couch, and we'd feed you tapes about how to be a good evaluator and a good speaker, and you'd learn it all just by watching TV. No. How many of you could watch a tennis match and then go be a tennis player? It doesn't work that way. You have to do it. Make it a habit. Get into a habit. Maybe it's a routine. Maybe it's a time of day it works best for you to work on your project. Never stop improving. Now, that is the end of the instructional portion. We've gone over a lot of ground. Before we begin our speech and evaluation session, where we actually try some of these in practice, are there any questions? Sir?
Behaviors of effective evaluator, point one, show that you care. And you highlighted the point that brings vocal variety. Now, in a setting where we have multicultural people, let's say, as I am, when I was taught English, I was forced to learn English in such a way that it doesn't have the intonations, which means vocal variety. Because my native language doesn't have that inherently. Right. And if it has expression, why is not in the vocal?
Right.
And I was appreciated a lot for that back home. But when I do that here, I either in the speeches I receive not so good feedback because my voice is flat, or my evaluations do not give the impression as if I care.
Right.
And I'm struggling with that. So in multicultural setting, where some of the languages part of the inherent part of behavior, how do I overcome? Or how do I let it be known to the listener that please be mindful of that fact that it is a multicultural person speaking, not the native speaker.
Right. A couple of thoughts on that. One, don't let it be an excuse for not understanding the need for it. I'm not saying it is, but don't let yourself make that an excuse and not try to change. Okay. The other would be when you're talking to your evaluator, yes, explain that. But decide for yourself. For instance, I noticed that your pronunciation is spot on. That's a skill that you had to learn from your primary language to English. Was your pronunciation always that way? Or did you have to learn when you came to the States and embedded in the American culture?
I took the language training.
Okay. So you were willing to make that change, and it was to be better understood. That was probably your reason and your motivation. So you decide for yourself whether making some modifications, practicing it, and the simple way to practice that would be to just record yourself. You don't need a video, just audio. And decide if you feel uncomfortable with that, if you don't want to do that. But if you do, there are ways to do it. But make sure your evaluator understands how you feel about it. And that you're not, if they think it's flat and therefore either boring or means that you don't care, explain to them that's not the case. And then you two decide how best to address it. But yeah, it's a serious issue. We all want to be understood. And we all want to be listened to in a way that makes people want to hear past the voice and get to the message. We're not saying words just to hear ourselves. We're saying words to convince or to persuade or to educate. Other questions? Yes.
In my club, I did a telecell where it's very time-oriented. Mm-hmm. So in that setting, we have 2 to 3 minutes to give the evaluation. How many times do you give an area of improvement if you have more of a member that's closer to their 10th speech or more advanced, right, going through their advanced books? I understand that maybe in the beginning you maybe just want to give one area of improvement and maybe talk to them afterwards, but you know, more of an advanced speaker, can you give 2, 3?
Oh, yeah. In fact, you probably shouldn't do any more than 2 or 3 at the most. But if only one comes to mind to you as the evaluator, because you are under some stress too, you're hearing it live, and you have to, especially if let's say your club only has 2 speakers, like my home club, the time from when I hear the speech number one to the time I'm evaluator number one, I only have about 10 minutes to think about this. And if I'm trying not to be too rude and sitting over in the corner scribbling, I have to listen to what's going on. So it's okay to have 2 or 3 things. Okay, I've gotten the high sign that we are going to go into the speaking portion.
Our first contestant tonight is Vajra Babu. No, he's not a contestant. He's our speaker. Vajra Babu Balakrishnan, could you imagine being so hungry that you could see every little detail of your bones? What if you didn't have enough energy to talk or even walk? Hunger can have a very powerful effect on your body. Examples are malnutrition and sickness. How to overcome the hunger and stay healthy? You may believe that eating healthy is too hard and a lot of work. You may also believe that grabbing a bag of candy at the checkout stand is easier than an apple from produce. But is it worth it to eat that much sugar? Vajra Babu Balakrishnan is going to give a speech entitled Hunger and Food. Hunger and Food, Vajra Babu Balakrishnan.
Good evening, fellow Toastmasters. Thank you for giving me opportunity to give a speech here. I came here to speak about hunger. So when I was driving, I started from home 4:30. When I was reaching here, I was in empty stomach. I was feeling tired. I was like, my eyes are little fading. My vision is fading. I was like, I'm going to give a speech. And first of all, I want to reach this place because I don't want to miss this session. I was telling Tim, I'm right on time. So the hunger, the feeling, the drain of energy, and you'll feel that lack of energy, you'll feel the weakness. That is a feeling we get in a day. Every 4 hours, we get the same feeling. And this feeling has happened. How it happens is the brain triggers the hormone called ghrelin. Because of this hormone, we are feeling this hunger. This hunger is common for all, even from any living organisms to people. We face this feeling, or we can call it as a disease, because this is happening in a lot of underdeveloped countries. And why I took this topic is, and 2 days back, when I was reading an article, there are 110 people died in Africa because of hunger. So this made me like, so why it's happening? Like we see that there's a lot of economies where we saw that one part of the globe is with huge economies, and the other part of the world, no economy, people are dying without food. So this made me like, well, why this is happening? So I become little emotional. I thought, okay, is there a way we can stop this? We have a lot of scientific developments. We see the technology is growing. We see a lot of food agriculture scientists did a lot of research. They increase the food production. We can see a lot of developments in a lot of technology. But still, we can't cure this. We can't call it as a disease, because we see that a lot of people are dying without food. And this happened for me in my life when I started my IT career. I had to go from my city to another place in India. The city I was in, Chennai, I had to go to Bangalore. Back in 2000, I was working in a IT company. It's a call center. I used to work 18 hours. It's not like I need to work 18 hours, but the thing is, like, I was staying as a bachelor, so I don't have anybody at room. I was staying in a room. I want people to interact. So my office is like my home. I used to be in the office. One night, I need to take a bus to reach my room. So I reached that, I took the bus, I reached. By the time I saw, it is the night 10:30. I don't see any restaurant. I see in the distance, I see a light. I went to a small restaurant was open. It's closing down. I was so hungry. When I stepped in, he looked at, he said in the local language, we are closing the shop. Oh, I was feeling, I was just returning back. He looked at me and he said, please just come in. So he had some food, he heated that food and he gave it to me. So I got the food. So the empty stomach knows the food importance. When I had the food, I remember that person, because on that night, without any food, how I struggled, he gave me the food. Still I remember that person. So when you feed an empty stomach, you will be always remembered. And now we see this is hunger is a sad part, but it's a nature. Nature has given to us. We need to feel hunger, because the hunger gives you to fight, to survive. So we can see, if you see that hunger for a sports person, this hunger is to win more medals. For a business person, banker, he earns to more money. That's a hunger. But for us, a common people, when the feeling, or we can call it as a disease, it makes us to, we have to survive this world. So we need to grab, somehow we grab the food. Like, we become an animal. When you are hunger, I like to bring a line from a Tamil song by the poet Avayar. We have to please, pardon me, because I have to bring this Tamil. I can translate it later. Pasi vandal pattum parandu pohum. This means, when you are hunger, the 10 characteristics will go away. The 10 characteristics are dignity, class in the society, education, strength, knowledge, donation attitude, penance, rank, generosity, and romance. If any of you are feeling hunger, you lose all these characteristics. We can say, we can challenge that. You can survive. You can survive for 21 days without food. But any of the person, we can't challenge going hunger for a long duration. As we see, when you're feeling hunger, the food, when Tim said, there is some food, I was so, wow, we immediately went for the food. Okay, the food is very important. When you have the food, it's like when you're hunger, imagine every day we are using the mobile, the battery is getting charging down. So the brain says, the ghrelin hormone, it says that it's a beep. You have to eat the food, you get charged up. So that's how, like, so we need to, when you're having food, nowadays we are looking at a lot of packed foods. So what we are doing, when we are hunger, we have started eating the chips. So this chip, they have that business technology, you can call it as. The flavor they add, it makes you to eat more and more. But what happens, the receptors in the stomach gets blocked. And this block, it tells that brain, the brain says that you stop eating, but the receptor is blocked and you keep on eating. So when you eat more and more, the bad things gets accumulated. You call it as a fat, then you need to run to the hospital, or you run to the doctor and the doctor will prescribe, please take this triglyceride. This happened to me. When I came to US, when I went to Costco, I was looked at, wow, it's a very big warehouse. I never seen this kind of, in my India, I've seen very small stores. I didn't see this kind of warehouse where with a lot of racks of food. When I went, when I looked at, I used to very fond of these desserts. When I eat all kind of sweets and all kind of food stuff. But finally, when my triglyceride hit me, when the doctor said you have to go on medication, so now I'm just following the medication. So first half of the life, I felt like I need to eat, live to eat. But the next half of the life, I'm thinking I need to eat to live. So we need to control ourselves. So thank you for the opportunity. I will request you all to eat well and stay healthy. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
If I could have your attention, I would like to introduce our second speaker this evening, Janet Skaggs. Janet Skaggs has been a Toastmaster for 1 year this month. Yay! Janet will be speaking out of the Competent Communicator Manual, speech number 8. Her objectives are listed after I tell you what it is. If you didn't know, number 8 is get comfortable with visual aids. This gives you a good idea. That's what we're going to do. Her objectives are to select visual aids that are appropriate for the message and the audience, and to use visual aids correctly with ease and confidence. How does a backpacker fit all that stuff in a pack? How does a backpacker actually carry all that stuff? Janet is going to show us how to pack a fully loaded backpack. Please welcome Janet Skaggs, how to pack a backpack. How to pack a backpack, Janet Skaggs.
We didn't know it was going to be quite the tongue twister, did we? How to pack a backpack. I'm very excited to have so many guests here this evening joining our local club. It is great to have all of you here. I have a passion for backpacking, and I'm excited that I get to share my passion with all of you. Backpacking, you have all your equipment in this one little sack. This is my typical equipment for approximately 3.5 days. 3 nights, 4th day you hike out. How do you get all this gear on your back and still be able to climb in and out of canyons, up and down mountains, and have your legs survive, and you still get to enjoy it? Well, part of my passion is to share with you the best way to pack a backpack. Now, Tom is going to be handing out a little bit of information that I'm going to explain. Most disciplines and most authors and most of your backpacking companies follow an ABC rule of packing a backpack. A stands for access. Access to the gear that you need when you need it. B for balance. How do you balance the backpack? Is there a good way or a preferred way to get all that gear into your backpack? And C, compression. What does that really mean? It means squishing everything together because we have to get that into the backpack. Now you will see on page 4, there is a picture of a backpack in the handout you just received. I will talk about the ABCs, but I'm going to do them in reverse order because that's the easiest way to get everything into the backpack. C, compression. What is the best way to do compression? This sleeping bag and this bag together weigh 2 pounds, 1 ounce. Now, if I just kind of shove it into a bag, it's still going to weigh the same. But if I use compression, and I want to stick this sleeping bag into this little bag for compression, will it still weigh the same? Yep. Yes, it will. It's still going to weigh the same. But how much space is it going to take up? A whole lot less, isn't it? So then I can use a smaller backpack. And I don't have to worry about using up all that space and carrying that big thing on my back. When you're doing your backpack and you're looking at that diagram, and we talk about balance, What is the heaviest thing that a backpacker is going to be carrying?
Water.
Yes, water. Second is usually food, depending upon how many days. So for water, 1 liter of water weighs 2 pounds. Where do we live?
Desert.
We live in the desert. We're going to be carrying a lot of weight and water, aren't we? Yes. Recommended approximately 3 liters if you're going out into the desert. And that's with a filter, so you can filter more water as you need. Now, if you look at that diagram on page 4 that I showed you, you'll notice that it recommends that your weight is in the middle of your back. So the weight, your heaviest weight, is in the middle of your back. So how do we do that with water? Well, with today's great technology, we have all these bladders and things like that that we use. So, this example, we have our bladders right here. This is in most of the modern backpacks. Our bladder's here, close to the back, because these are our straps. And I still have access into my backpack. We're going to start with putting our sleeping bag in the bottom. It's light. I don't need it till I get to camp. I don't have to have access to it. So I put that right here. Second heaviest thing, food. I need to put that right next to the water in the middle of my backpack. Keep it right there. I don't need this food right away, so the access to it is not pertinent, so I can put it down in there. Now we need to balance this and have compression. On the next page of your handout, you'll see kind of like a brick wall. And that talks about you're packing your backpack like a brick wall, and the mortar is all your other things that you can stuff in to bring compression. We want our food bag to stay stable. Sleeping pad, nice and light, right in front. Snug right in there like that. Clothes bag, nice and light. I don't bring too many clothes. I can stick that right in there on the front. Now I'm getting some holes. I need some mortar, rain pants. Just stick them on down in there. Down jacket, ooh, nice and squishable. Getting everything in here. First aid kit. We have our water filter, nice and accessible on the top lid. Our tent on top. And we use all our squishy material to be that mortar that we pack in so we're nice and tight. We have easy access to our headlamp in case we need it. So that goes on the top. We have our camera on the top. Our potty pack on the top because that's important too. The cameras go in the waist. In the waist and the back. And then you've got a backpack. Nice and solid, nice and compressed, and it's nicely balanced. So it's the ABCs of packing a backpack. Access, so the foods and the things that you need. Balance, getting that weight in the middle, in the back, and compression, getting all that stuff to fit.
Our third speaker this evening is Tom Lindsay. Tom Lindsay is going to be speaking. I'm not sure which one it is.
International contest speech.
It's an international speech contest. Speech. Sorry about that. Tom Lindsay has been a member of Fountain Hills Toastmasters Club since 2016. He is a retired school administrator and has lived in Fountain Hills for 12 years. He loves to run and hike, read, and travel with his wife, Jan. This speech is in honor of Jan's dad, Larry Letterman. Tom Lindsay, lessons learned from Larry, lessons learned from Larry, Tom Lindsay.
It was a simple question. My mom and dad are coming to visit from Milwaukee. My dad loves to play racquetball and needs something to do. Would you please play with him? Said Jan, my co-worker. Little did I know, that game and that day would change my life forever. Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, I got up the next morning and went for an easy 6-mile run because I was still only 28 and single and had lots of time and was training. I met Jan and her dad at the racquetball court, and when I got there, I was a little relieved because there was this 66-year-old, short, bald guy, even shorter than me, with pear flyers, cotton gym shorts, a white t-shirt, and of all things, a wooden racket. Whew, I said, that was a tough run. I could use an easy game. We got on the court. I served first with my famous zigzag serve. I served, boom! Kill shot went flying right by me. I got into my position to wait for his serve. I got rather low so I could maybe do a kill shot. He served, poof! I never saw it to the right. Got down again, poof! To the left. On and on and on, the same thing. 3 games, he won 21-1, 21-2, 21-1, and never moved more than 2 steps. I said, Jan, who is this guy? Oh, did I forget to tell you? My dad is one of the inventors of racquetball and is in the International Hall of Fame. You might have told me before. The next time I met her dad, it was a little different. We were married. I inherited a wife, a 3-year-old, and an Afghan hound all at once. And it convinced her to move to Maine from Arizona. Well, Larry visited us with his wife, Eve. And Eve was in the beginning stages of Alzheimer's. And we were living in an up-down duplex. And we tried to watch her carefully, but she got out. And she was upstairs, and she was knocking on the door, lost. And the neighbor brought her down, and it was only a couple minutes later that Jan and her dad had to put Eve into a facility. And Larry visited her every day he was in Milwaukee for 7 years that she had Alzheimer's. That was a lesson about dedication and sacrifice to somebody you love. We left Maine after the 3rd snowstorm, and it was only October, and came back to Arizona. And Larry came to visit us anywhere from a week to several months over the next 24 years. And each visit was an adventure. Because Larry, to use his own words, was quite a guy. He'd come with this huge suitcase, and packed inside, he'd have this big 3 to 4 pound chunk of prime rib frozen, because The Midwest corn-fed beef was far superior to the Southwest grass meat. And he always kept busy. It was like having somebody working for you. He'd rake the leaves, he'd cook when we had meetings, he went shopping every day. Every single day to Fry's, and he went to McDonald's for his fish sandwich, and he also went to Tip Top Nursery. We had the biggest collection of plants that didn't match in all of Mesa. But the best thing was his spending time with his two grandsons. They loved to hear Grandpa's stories about growing up in the Depression, and when he was a Big Ten wrestling champ, and that he knew all of the Packers and the Milwaukee Brave players who came to his athletic club to play racquetball. And he loved when he took his two boys to Hometown Buffet, because they would go back again and again and again to get the prime rib and all of the other meat, and he'd come home and say, "Boy, those boys can meet. I got my money's worth today." During one of his visits in 2001, Larry had his first heart attack. And we spent the 2001 Super Bowl in the hospital with our traditional pot of chili, fortunately cheering my New England Patriots to their first Super Bowl victory. He kept coming back because Larry, well, he lived up to another one of his sayings. "You know, you gotta be tough to be old." But the big thing was how he loved the boys and the boys loved him. And in 2004, he had another heart attack and he went into hospice. And while he was there, my older son decided Grandpa needed to go to a spring training game. He put him in a wheelchair, put him in his Mustang, and Grandpa had an accident. And the 6'2", 210-pound son brought him to our house and cleaned him up and then brought him to Diablo Stadium for 2 or 3 innings. That was the last time that Larry was outside of hospice. My boys visited him every single day he was there, just like he visited Eve for 7 years. I learned a lot from Larry, but the single most important lesson that I learned, and you can learn too, is love is about making the other person's needs more important than your own. I'm a Toastmaster.
Three speeches. Three very different speeches, which is typical of Toastmasters, isn't it? You never know what you're going to get. So now is the time to have our evaluators come up, and we'll see what they have to say. I'd like you to be following along on your written guide. If you're not the featured evaluator, follow along and be thinking, did I see the same things? Do I have the same conclusions? What kind of recommendations would I have given if I were giving that evaluation? First, to evaluate the first speech, please welcome Russell Forbes.
Thank you, Don. Toastmasters. Basna Babu Balakrishna. Thank you for a very interesting speech about food and hunger. You made great eye contact with people and showed you were passionate. You had good vocal variety. But sometimes you'd look away and you'd kind of go like this. And we kind of you'd lose us for a second while you looked away. And I like that you'd come up to the front of the audience, but then you'd back off too. And you'd kind of shrink. When you back off like this, you kind of shrink a little bit just because our perspective is from sitting down is that way. And so if you could stay up here and you can move back and forth. I like your opening. You really personalized it. And should give us a glimpse of being hungry. And you repeat it, why you're interested in being hungry. And then a little bit I lost about where you were going with it when you were in India, and then you gave us some great examples about what hunger does to us and what we lose in our civility. But I wasn't quite sure where we're going, so maybe a little outline at the beginning of your speech might be helpful to keep us on track. And then you can repeat what you're doing. And that helps us cement where we are and helps us know to listen to you clearly. You had minimal use of notes, and I really like that too. It's appropriate to have notes for quoting, and that was great. So it was great that you didn't have to rely on any notes to do your speech. And it was an appropriate length of time. And then I did like the interesting facts again that you did on your speech. And then why, again, at the end, your conclusion, you repeated why it was personal to you. And using your medicine. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Russell. To evaluate speech number two, please welcome Matt Gerdatowski. Matt, I should know better. It's been too long.
Janitor, first let me say congratulations on your first year in Toastmaster. Everyone give a round of applause to Janitor.
Yeah.
I'm traveling for business next week. Can you come over and pack for me, please, Janitor? Very great tips you pointed out this evening for us. Janitor was speaking from the Competent Communicator Manual, Project Number 8, Getting Comfortable with Visual Aids. I felt your passion as soon as you began talking about this subject tonight, Janitor. I saw the excitement in your eyes, and it lasted the entire speech. Really brought me in to want to pay close attention to what you were going to explain to us this evening. The speech was broken into three parts, an A, a B, and a C. Janet, you did a fantastic job of laying that out for us in the beginning, the outline of what I was going to talk about this evening. Then you did what I thought was a beautiful thing. You told us, though it was A, B, and C, tonight I was going to talk about it in reverse order. So I wasn't caught off guard when you suddenly talked about compression at the beginning. I knew that you were going to go from C to B to A. So I appreciate that you outlined it for us. You let us know what the order was going to be. We weren't caught off guard by that. I enjoyed how you identified objects as mortar. I thought that was a great way to kind of glue it all together as you were packing your backpack. Good use of vocabulary words there. For an opportunity to improve on the compression visual, it took a long time to stuff that big sleeping bag into the little pouch. My suggestion for improvement was maybe have a second visual with the backpack already compressed. We could say, here's how much compression that I can shrink this down and then place it in the backpack. I thought that would be the only opportunity that I would present to you for improvement down the road. I looked in your manual for some of the previous comments evaluators had given to you, and I saw that summary and conclusion was often mentioned. Tonight, you nailed it. You went back through A, B, and C for us. Strong conclusion, probably the best one I've ever seen from your speeches over the past 8 projects you've done. And the second previous comment for improvement was moving across the floor with a purpose. I saw that all tonight during your speech. Everything was purpose, the way you picked the backpack up for us as you were stuffing objects in. We could see from the back of the room where you were placing things. All your movements were with purpose this evening. So congratulations, Janet. Wonderful speech tonight. Personally, I think it was the best one I've ever seen you give. Good job, Janet.
Thank you, Matt. And our final evaluator for speaker number three is Sunil Sharma.
Tom, I think you have got this speech for international speech contest. If you can put together Alzheimer's, depression, heart attack, child, and resilience, all in one single, coherent, captivating story, you definitely have a speech for international contest. Congratulations for having such a good, great speech. Your body movement, the way you started to capture attention of the audience, all those shots, and then again the body movement, all this gave me the impression as if you were not a school administrator, probably you were some kind of community theater Toastmasters, if there exists something like that. I'm not sure if you were actually in reality. The way you concluded on the point of love and need of others being more important and equally emphasizes that, that was exactly spot on. Very good ending with a conclusive remark. So again, a great point there. Areas of improvement, again the cultural thing, which I raised in my question. In the middle of this speech, there was a point of some Midwest and non-Midwest. So I not being from United States, I actually could not understand what it is. So since it is international contest, probably may want to keep this in your mind, who are going to be the judge. So if they are going to be people not from United States, they'll say, hang on, what was that? Why it's a big deal if something is not from Midwest or something is from somewhere else. But that's again the cultural thing. That's not my opinion. Probably you want to seek feedback from others. The key point for me, in my personal opinion again, your statement, for being old you got to be tough. This took half of the fear from me of being old. So that's good. That at least I can glorify. At least this can glorify. I can glorify myself that, okay, I'm. So what? I will be old. I will be tough. That's fine. All right. Yes, as I said, you have this speech, and this kind of speeches are best suited for international speech context. I have not heard other contenders. Otherwise, I would have designated you already a winner in my. Thank you very much.
Thank you to each of our three evaluators. Now, I don't know about you, but I did not evaluate the speeches as they were happening. I was taking care of the camera, but I was evaluating the evaluators as they were evaluating. I'll get to that in a minute. Comments about the evaluations from your perspective. What did you find that wasn't mentioned in any of the evaluations? Something that, a positive that they missed? Ideas? What about points for improvement? Did you have any additional ways that any of the three speakers could improve that wasn't included in the evaluations?
Oh, our evaluators of the speak.
Yeah. So in other words, as you're listening to these evaluators, did they miss something that you would have said if you were the evaluator?
Yes. I have something. On Janet's speech, I thought her opening was especially warm. It was friendly, the way she opened her speech.
Okay.
Maybe that was something that could have been pointed out.
Okay. Other ideas on any of the speakers? That something that you thought the evaluator either missed or could have included?
I have another one.
Okay.
This one's for Vajra. On his conclusion, he said thank you to all of us. We're really supposed to be thanking you for giving the speech. Just eliminate the word, have a good, strong conclusion. We'll be able to tell when you're done. Or if we can't, you can always say, Madam Toastmaster.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Ellen?
Oh, gosh, I do not feel good. I'm sorry. I did want to mention that I heard a really long opening from Vajra before we got into the story. I know a little bit more since I was a timer,
that it went over, and I thought if you could condense your introduction a little bit and get into your stories. I loved your stories for each one. And I've seen Vajra for the past year and a half, and I'm telling you, this guy has improved so much. It's exciting to, I don't know if I'm still choked up. I don't know, but I would just say condense your introduction and get into your stories of what you're trying to get us to remember. Well done.
I want to share a few of my observations of the evaluators. Russell, I noticed that you were using the you and your words more than the I and me words. You notice how I started that sentence? I noticed that you were doing something. Keep it, again, that's hard. It's hard. It's a habit we need to get into. Start with my impressions of your evaluations were good. I particularly liked the way that you mentioned the no notes. That's always a strong point to bring out, especially for a beginning speaker. I thought that your suggestion for him moving backwards and kind of fading into the back was excellent, but I would have put that at the end or in the middle. It was kind of your opening shot. Matt, your use of the I versus you was about even, about 50-50. You were more analytical, and I appreciated how you broke down. See how easy it is? I appreciated how you broke down the ABC and used that as part of your evaluation organization as well. Sunil, you had many more I's than you's. Excellent. You were telling the story from your perspective. And I appreciate that. I also appreciate your emphasis on the positive words about the speaker. And I don't know about you, but I hadn't even thought of the international cultural division of a local question, like beef from the Midwest is better than the Southwest. And you're right, in an international competition, that might not work. So all three of you did an excellent job evaluating. And we are now a little over time. Are there any final questions or comments about anything you've heard tonight? Anything maybe that the evaluators missed? I want each of you that filled out a paper evaluation, make sure that speakers get that before they leave tonight, just like you would in a regular club meeting, so they can take it home, look at your comments. Madam Toastmaster, do you have any final remarks before we conclude the evening?
I would love for Tim to
take... Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. President.
I guess I might have a question. So he talked about evaluating the evaluator at the club level. But in our club, we always select a best evaluator. Very similar to best topic, best speaker, likewise best evaluator. So in your opinion, do you think that is a kind of evaluating the evaluator, or it's something more than that should be?
That, to my mind, is more of picking a winner, and not a, just like in a speech contest. We don't evaluate a speaker in a speech contest. We judge them. Who's better? Who's second? Who's third? If I win the trophy for best evaluator, I don't know why I won it. What was it special about mine versus, was it just an opinion? But if you can break it down, and you don't necessarily have to spend nearly as long as I did. It can be maybe 30 seconds, a minute, 2 minutes at most. If you can fit that into your agenda. Now, every time we change an agenda, you got to worry about the overall time and all of that. So each club has its own way to do that. But I still recommend you do it. Mr. President, take us home.
Thank you, all of you, for coming tonight to Fountain Hills Toastmasters. In the interest of time, I don't want to take away from your evening. I would like to have you all come back. I'm extending an invitation to all of our guests. Come back, see how we manage a normal meeting. See how we are an innovator in the District 3 Toastmasters environment. I was talking earlier with Will about how we're going to try to bring in remote access via video conferencing members in. He is only here for part of the year. Something that we're going to be trying. We are part of that culture to try to bring new and exciting innovations in. You saw that perhaps in our flyer today. Come on back, have a great time. We meet Wednesdays, every Wednesday at 6:30 right here in the VFW. If you do have any questions or comments to share with me, I would love to hear from you after our club meeting. And if there's no further comments, my magic gavel says it is time to close. Thank you so much for coming to Fountain Hills Toastmasters.